Check, 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 check.
Nobody gets what I say. Must be some way to convey it. But no one else remembers. Just those parts that I play. Nobody gets. Nobody gets me but you. No one gets what I'm doing. Everyone else seems to look through it. Oh, but maybe I never wanted them to. Couldn't count on it anyway. Nobody gets me. Nobody cuts me like you.
Thank you. Don't set on the mystery zone. How jungle, it feels so familiar when you've never been there. How could it seem so unreachable? You never tried to find, never tried to find the mystery zone. Off of the mystery zone. And when you know love, when you find it for real, it contains the emotion sense of everyone ready. Your cover was blown, you weren't there, but you were. Ooh, in the mystery zone.
Last one still stings. It's alright, Friday night to Sunday. It feels alright, keeps your mind on the page. I have small stakes and show you the minimum rules. We don't feel taken and you don't feel abused. Small stakes tell you that there's nothing to do. Can't think big, can't think past one or two. We're no lie. Up your nose, but your life on the page. So come on, tell me you're wrong.
Back to me. And now we're down by the sea wall. there. And I wanna show you how I love you, but there's nothing there. I'm not standing here. I'm not standing here. I'm riding in reverse. Now it gets worse. Now I'm not standing here. I'm not standing here. I'm not standing here. I'm not standing here. Now I'm riding in reverse. I'm now it gets worse. And I hear that famous song.
Welcome to this event. I'm Josh Antonuccio, and I'm going to read off the script for just a minute here, because I don't want to forget some of the people I want to thank. But first of all, just on behalf of the Scripps College of Communication and the School of Media Arts and Studies, I just want to thank you for joining us today. We are live streaming today's event at the School of Media Arts and Studies website, which is mediaschool.ohio.edu. So if you're joining us online, you can watch along, and then you can post questions via Twitter using the hashtag AskOUMDIA, which is coming up behind us. So I'd encourage you to ask questions. We won't get to all of them, but as they pertain to the conversation, we will be pulling some in. At the end of the event today, for like the last 15 minutes, we've got mics up on either side, so feel free to come down and ask a question, and we'll leave some time for that at the end. Just a quick bit of thank yous here. First of all, just thanks to Scott Titsworth, Becky Fox, and Aaron Roberts in the Scripps College of Communication for making this possible and for all their help. For Kyle Snyder, the School of Media Arts and Studies, for all of his technical help and support. Josh Boyer in the School of Music for helping to make this event possible here in the School of Music. And also students Stephen Van Dyne, Sean Livingston, and Michael France for helping out with audio. We've also got a number of other students assisting, and this wouldn't be possible without them. Also just want to say thanks to Larry Crane, Tape Op Magazine, for sharing about our event today. And hopefully a number of people with production questions will feel free to chime in throughout the event today. So let me share a bit about our guest. Jim Eno is the drummer, co-founder, and producer for the band Spoon. For the band Spoon, get some applause. For that. A fantastic band, a band that has crafted a nearly two-decade run of both critical and commercial success. Along with Britt Daniel, Jim Eno helped co-found Spoon in the mid-90s in Austin, Texas. And since that time, they've gone from being a critically acclaimed underground band to become one of the most consistently creative and successful alternative rock acts in the indie genre. Spoon released its debut EP in 1994 and would go on to land a signing with the legendary indie label Merge in the early 2000s. Albums from that era, such as Girls Can Tell and Kill the Moonlight, brought the band a devoted fan base, with the latter album spawning the single The Way We Get By, which was featured on the popular teen drama The OC. As a result, Spoon gained greater critical acclaim, leading up to their 2005 breakthrough album, Gimme Fiction, which took them to number 44 on the Billboard charts. With its release and the strength of their subsequent tour, Spoon gained a new level of recognition for their distinctive sound. 2007's Ga 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 found Spoon reaching another pinnacle, with the album landing them a number 10 Billboard debut spot and sales of over 300,000 copies in the US. The album topped nearly every major critics' year-end list, and by 2008, Spoon were solidified as icons of the indie rock genre. As such, Spoon became fixtures on film soundtracks, television programs, and late-night talk shows. In 2010, the band released its seventh full-length album, Transference, which debuted at number 4 on the Billboard 200. Last year, Spoon returned with the announcement of their eighth and most recent album, They Want My Soul, which found them working with a new label and studio masterminds Dave Fridman and Joe Ciccarelli. The album debuted at number 4 on the Billboard charts, and they have since debuted songs off the new album on The Daily Show, Late Night with David Letterman, Jimmy Kimmel Live, and The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon. Next month, Spoon head out for a three-month national tour with performances at major venues across the U.S. this summer and headlining spots at major festivals including Bonnaroo and Sasquatch. Jim Eno also owns and operates the world-renowned studio Public Hi-Fi in Austin, Texas, where he serves as chief producer and engineer. Started the studio in the late 90s, and since then, they have seen clients as varied as Lady Gaga, Arcade Fire, Justin Timberlake, and Explosions in the Sky. And they've played a prominent role in the production and engineering of countless national artists. Jim has developed a career as an in-demand producer, engineer, and studio musician, and has worked on too many great albums to name, but just a few: Black Joe Lewis, Alejandro Escovado, Heartless Bastards, Tennis, and Telekinesis, and the list could go on. So please join me in welcoming Jim Eno to Ohio University.
I wanted that seat.
Welcome, Jim.
Hi.
So just to start, I want to say congratulations. Spoon has had an incredible year. So South by Southwest, you guys had three or four major performances there, including Lake Shores.
Auditorium Shores, yep.
Yeah. Auditorium Shores, so 20,000 people at that show.
Yep.
What was the award that you guys took?
The Brent Grilke Award. Mm-hmm. Yep.
And then you guys head out for some really significant performances this summer across the
May and June, yep.
Yeah. Yep. So how does it feel kind of looking back now? Yeah, I've been watching, rewatching the show West Wing, you know, and they have these episodes where like they show how they got there, you know, kind of from the beginning. When you look back, how do you kind of view the trajectory of your career? And now that you're going and playing these major festivals, having such great turnouts in a place where you guys started in Austin, Texas, what does it feel like?
Well, it feels great, but it, for us, things happened very slowly. A lot of people didn't go in the early years for a very long time, and very gradually, like pretty much after 2001, we started getting people coming to our shows. So for us, it hasn't been like a radio kind of thing that had us take off. It's basically been Britt writing great songs, us putting out really good records, and just touring constantly. And then you go to a place and you play in front of 100, then it's 300, then it's 500, and you know, the 10th time you go back, you may, you're playing more. So it, so it just feels very gradual, very, you know, very good feeling though.
So I think most people would look at your career and the career of Spoon and think, wow, like you just became a rock star. You signed to this huge, very influential label, Merge Records, quit your day jobs, go out and make a ton of money. But that wasn't quite the case. Like you, you kept your day job for quite some time all through the, throughout that time, right?
Yeah, yeah. I have a degree in electrical engineering. So I went to NC State in Raleigh, North Carolina. And I mean, I started playing drums when I was a junior in college. So I started everything pretty late. And moved to Houston to work at Compaq Computer, and then to Austin to work at Motorola. And I had a day job up until we started recording Ga 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 Ga. So that was maybe 2007.
So Give Me Fiction comes out. Everybody's losing their minds about that album. And you guys are taking off and you're still working.
Yes.
So how did you manage that? And what was the thinking behind it?
Well, back in 1996, when we signed to Matador, our producer, John Krause, and I'm like, should I just quit my day job? What should I do? And he's like, when it's time to quit your day job, it's going to be black and white for you. I'm like, okay, well, that's cool. And it definitely was. I was at a startup company. I was running the team in Austin, about 15 people. And my boss was like, hey, Jim, I'm coming to Austin, and our partner may pull out. If they pull out, then I'm shutting the company down. So he came out. He's like, yes, they pulled out. I'm shutting the company down now, and no severance or anything. And that was 2 weeks before we were going to start Ga 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 Ga.
Black and white.
Black and white right there, yeah. So I never interviewed, never, you know, didn't look for another job, and I've been, you know, doing music full-time since then. I've been really fortunate. But I also knew it's what I wanted to do, and I was had been planning to try to be able to do that since about for about 10 years.
So you mentioned Matador. So talk a little bit about the process of how you and Britt met and how you landed that first deal.
Let's see. Britt and I met because he was working, going to school at UT, University of Texas, in the radio, television, and film group. And he had to do a recording project. And he was playing with this friend of his named Brad Shenfield. They had a band and they needed a drummer. I had done a gig with Brad, maybe one or two of them. And so they called me to do the session. I went there, recorded maybe five or six songs that I had never heard before. And they were, you know, wow, how can he do this? He's never heard these songs before. But when I was in Houston, I played jazz for 2 years straight. That's all I played, big band and combo. So I was used to charts and just sort of mapping things out. And so it was sort of easy for me. But then I started playing with that band. Me, Britt, and Brad, it was a band called the Alien Beats, which was a rockabilly country band. And then that band broke up. Fast forward about 10 years, and now Brad is our lawyer. He's Spoon's lawyer. And
that's convenient.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then Britt and I, Britt is like, hey, I got these songs. Do you want to come listen to them? And we played about five or six songs off of Telefono, and it just like blew me away.
So you landed the deal, and then you had a major label opportunity to come out with Elektra. What was that like to finally get this big opportunity to come along?
Well, we had a lot of interest on the first record, and but we got an offer from Matador Records that is a big fan of ours, and so we ended up taking that. But I don't know, for some reason that record didn't click with people, and so we decided to look around a little bit. So we had this offer from Elektra Records, and we took that because we thought of everything that could possibly go wrong, but we missed a few things.
So what derailed that whole process for you guys?
The A&R guy had a falling out with the president of Elektra, Cynthia Roan, and then we were dropped about 3 months after the record came out. So
you guys had this major label opportunity, it falls apart. How does that lead you to the doorsteps of Merge?
Well, we started, you know, we were trying to figure out what we were going to do, you know, and looking at whether do we keep Spoon going and everything. And it was a dark time there. I can pinpoint the darkest point too.
What was the darkest point?
So we were recording, Britt and I were recording on a 1-inch 8-track tape machine that we borrowed from a friend of ours, and it was an awful piece of gear, right? We had 5 songs recorded, and I was rewinding the tape, and then right in the middle, it snaps. So the tape snaps, and we have no idea where it is in the tape. And so we were both just looking at each other, and we're like, can anything else go wrong here? We finally have some songs recorded, and so I'm like, okay, no, let's see what happens. So I cut the tape, spliced it back together, and rewound it, and the song is playing. It fades out. I see the splice go by, and then the next song starts.
No way.
And to me, that was going from the lowest point to things just starting to get a little bit better. And because then after that, after the splice incident, we...
sounds like a good album title,
yeah,
for
exactly.
A feature album.
We, you know, the songs on Girls Can Tell are amazing. And so they liked it. And I just remember in the van after Girls Can Tell came out, and we're like listening to NPR and they're talking about our record, and we're just like, we could get no one to go to our shows from 1994 to 2001. You know, that's 7 years of, we call it the locust years. And it's like really, really hard. And then finally, again, slowly, gradually, things just started getting better.
Well, it seems too, through the locust years, you guys were really finding your sound and what would define kind of the essence of Spoon. And that's actually the point when I first got introduced to you. My friend Stephen Tootle, who I was in a band with, played me Small Stakes.
And, oh, okay, yeah.
And I remember he was like, now just listen to this song. And you know, the keyboard's coming in, if you're familiar with the song, and the tambourine comes in, and you're waiting for the drums to push everything.
Yeah.
He's like, this is why it's so brilliant. They never bring the drums in. and then there's that great distant drum sound that's just kind of chaotic in one ear, and that's the song.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he's like, isn't this band amazing? And I was like, yeah, it's great. And that sold me. But it made me realize, like, that's part of what you guys brought to the kind of musical vocabulary is really great pop songs, but that are always housed with an angular element that are always cracking at some point that you don't expect them to.
Right, right.
So when you get to Give Me Fiction, then it's like you have this whole sound that has just been developed all through almost that entire decade.
Yeah, I feel like our first two records were different than that, though. I feel like our first record was a sort of capture what we do live kind of thing. And Britt even says, he's like, I wanted to be in a band that played fast, quick songs, short songs, because he felt like we would get more gigs. You know, and that was the thing. If we could play Hole in the Wall on campus on a Friday night in headline, it's like, we made it. You know, that kind of thing. And so that was the idea behind that record. And then Series of Sneaks was exploring a little bit more, but it was definitely still rock and roll, you know, like, well, like, I guess more alt rock, I guess, you know. And then when Girls Can Tell happened, you know, he had been listening to a lot of like Marvin Gaye, and he basically threw everything up and is like, I think, you know, anything is fair game to put on a Spoon song. Mm-hmm. Good piano, it's fine. It's like, it's no, you know, I'm just going to do what I feel is right. And so a lot of that change of sound happened on Girls Can Tell. And I feel like that is a changing point that we've been sort of crafting since then.
Oh, yeah. So along with that, though, you guys have really seen the entire music industry change through the locust years and beyond and through the 2000s with the growth of the internet and streaming music and digital files and then the loss of kind of the decline of digital files that we're kind of in right now. Yet at the same time, you guys have managed to have a really successful career. So how have you kind of managed to navigate through all of the changes that have been going on?
I don't know. I mean, you know, we just try to keep putting out good records, you know? When it comes to how people are listening to music, it's not really for us to tell you how to listen to your music. If you want to do it downloading or buying or streaming, it's like, yeah, you know, mm-hmm. just check out ours and check out as much different music as you can, you know? Mm-hmm. So for us, we focus on the records, and I mean, I feel like with social media, that's a little bit outside of our comfort zone, because we grew up in, like, before all that, and...
So you got to share the story last night that you told me about what it was like to tour before cell phones and before internet.
I don't see how we used to do it. I just remember, like, we had a, you know, a road atlas, you know, one of those. It was paper.
Paper.
Yeah. And, like, if we were, you know, it would be like, oh, Athens, Ohio, you know, and we'd be like, okay, so there's just one little dot that says Athens, Ohio. How are we going to find the club, mm-hmm. you know? So we would have to pull in, well, the other thing was interviews, right? Now, we had to do interviews on the road, so we would find rest areas or gas stations and with banks of payphones and have calling cards and have to all be there doing phone interviews on payphones and then call the club and say, how do we get, we're at this exit 35 on some road, and, you know, and get talked in. I mean, it was pretty crazy.
Yeah. So I have a few questions coming through just about your role as a producer and alongside of being the drummer and
musician. A little weird. Yeah. I'm just going to ignore that there.
Yeah, so how did you happen to that role? From the beginning, were you always producing? Were you always engineering?
From like how I started then?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, back around, I guess, 98 or so, around Series of Sneaks, around the time we got dropped, I had been buying, like, I bought an Audio Media 3 Pro Tools system. You probably remember that, right? And started learning the software. And because when I went into the studio, I knew I liked it. And so I did it because I felt like we could be more self-sufficient. So that's one of the things about Spoon is trying to do as much ourselves as possible. Like, every record we've ever recorded, we've recorded it ourselves, and then we've brought it to the label. So that is good for two things. We retain all artistic control. You don't have someone telling you what to do.
So if you want to smash a piano,
we can do it.
You can do it.
If we want to do a polka record, we could do it. We haven't yet, but you know.
But you did smash a piano.
We did smash a piano, yeah. The other thing is it gives you more leverage. We license all our records too. So the idea that you talk to a label and you're like, well, you shouldn't own this record because we're delivering it to you completed, and what are you bringing to the table? We want it back in 7 years, that kind of thing. It gives you a little more leverage as opposed to getting money from them then using that to record the record. So we've sort of tried to pipeline everything and be as self-sufficient as possible. So back around then, I started buying gear. I met John Vanderslice. I don't know if anyone knows him. Tiny Telephone, one of the most
great studio.
Amazing people in the world is John. And he called me out of the blue. I used to live in a town called Pflugerville. It begins with a P. Yeah. And I get this.
Sounds awesome.
Yeah, I just get this call from some crazy Muppet, John Vanderslice, and he's just talking my ear off around about gear, and I ended up modeling a lot of my gear around what he does, and his idea was always to just buy old vintage gear because it appreciates in value, it sounds great, and it's going to make your studio more valuable for people to come in, because, you know, everyone can't afford, you know, a U67 or a 47. So I started the gear addiction of buying a lot of gear and building a studio, and then did that for a while. But going back to the day job thing, to quit my day job, I felt like I had to diversify as much as possible. I had to have as many different things to do as possible. So I figured studio work was really good, and I really enjoyed it. You know, it's very creative for me as a drummer to work with other bands and other musicians, and I love it. So that was part of the master plan to quit the day job.
Yeah. So, but that idea of diversifying what you're doing. So you're playing drums, you're touring, you're owning a studio, you're also maintaining a day job, and you guys are writing and kind of moving on to the next project.
Correct, right.
So how do you keep that schedule? How do you?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I look back on it now and I'm like, how did I do it? And you know, everyone always says that, you know. But my tours, it was funny, all the companies I worked with, my benefits would expire in 30 days. So a lot of our initial tours were 29 days. And so I would come back just one day early to keep my benefits. So yeah, the band was very accommodating with that, so that was good.
Well, you mentioned licensing, so I want to just, I have to read this because I'm just astonished by the amount of shows and films you guys have licensed to. So a brief list, television-wise: Shameless, Veronica Mars, How I Met Your Mother, Bones, Chuck, Scrubs, The Simpsons, House, Numbers, films, Cloverfield, which is impressive because there's almost no music in that film. You guys are in the party sequence.
Oh, right, yeah, yeah.
Horrible Bosses, 17 Again, I Love You Man, 500 Days of Summer. And then Stranger Than Fiction, which Britt had a big hand in.
Yeah, yeah.
So has that been an intentional strategy for the band to always be finding a way to have an outlet through television, film, to get people to discover your music?
Yeah, I think so. I think so. For some reason, around that period of time, our music was really resonating with people, and we got a lot of requests for that. I feel like the times are changing now. A lot of times they are looking more for bands that are unsigned or not even known. It's like that's another way that now music licensing companies are making their mark, is we broke this band on this show, that kind of thing. So I feel like it's a little bit more difficult now than it used to be, but it was a good, you know, a good thing for us to do. It helped us pay the bills and it helped us pay for recording, you know. The tricky thing is always when you record and when you write music, you are not thinking of visuals when you do that. But now all of a sudden you're in a song, is in a car commercial, and all of a sudden now that is inherently tied to it. So you have to sort of think about, you know, who you're associating your music with. And we try to, like, you know, be as tasteful as we can with it.
So do you guys, how does that work? Like, you'll get an offer that comes in, do you talk about it and kind of feel like, is it a good fit, the product that wants to use it and the band's sound?
Yeah, yeah. A lot of it, Britt writes the song, so he controls all of that. So, you know, but there are some times where it's just like, you know, the U.S. Army? No, we're not.
I've heard of them, yeah.
Yeah. You know, commercials for that, or, you know, we've turned down things in the past where we just didn't feel like it was a good fit. So
along with licensing, obviously the live music experience, you guys are a great live band. I've seen you twice. How many people have been to a Spoon show at some point? Yeah, so a good number of people. So where did you feel like you were talking before about how you saw the numbers growing at all those shows? Like, where did you finally get to a point where you're like, wow, this is like something's really catching on. We're really noticing we've kind of turned a corner out of the locust years and into really kind of being accepted into the mainstream.
Right. I feel like there were two things for me personally. The NPR tour I was talking about, the very first tour on Girls Can Tell. We had a show booked at the Bowery Ballroom in New York City, and I think it's about 500 or something. I can't remember, probably about that. Every day we would get updates on how many tickets were sold. And so first day it was, oh, 150, cool. We're at 180, we're at 250, oh, we're at 350. And I remember getting right around to Chicago, and we would always anticipate these numbers, and then it's like, wow, we sold out. This is unbelievable. And they're like, they want to add another show. So we added another show the next day, and then it's like, oh wow, 150, 200, and again, slowly. So when we finally got to New York, it was two sold out shows at this place called Bowery Ballroom, where I just remember playing a club called Brownies in front of 10 people, like, eight times, you know. And so that was a point where it was like, wow, this is, you know, people are getting this. Yeah. It was really exciting.
What an amazing experience. Yeah.
And then the next time was when we did SNL. Mm-hmm. That was,
what year was that?
That was 2008, I think. Uh-huh. Yeah. So that, I mean, You never think you're going to be on SNL.
Yeah. So you mentioned NPR, though. Yeah. So you mentioned NPR. They've had a big role in helping to kind of carry you guys. Talk a little bit about their involvement in the most recent album and kind of how that was part of the release strategy for the album.
Let's see. Well, yeah, we've done. Did they premiere the record?
You did the live premiere of the song.
Oh yeah, right. Yeah. Yep. Yeah. I don't know. Obviously we're fans of all those different stations and their programming. So we tend to try to tie them in as much as possible. You know, Sound Opinions. We were on. Big fan of those guys. When we talk about releasing a record, there's a lot of different things that go into it. Who is going to help us and everything? So NPR has always been a major supporter of us.
Yeah. So I got a number of questions coming through about the sounds of the albums. So maybe talk a little bit, like maybe from Gimme Fiction through the next two albums, just how the what was kind of behind the sound, the people that you worked with that helped craft that.
Let's see. So Girls Can Tell for the next 3, 4, 5 records was Mike McCarthy was producing with all of us. So me, Britt, and Mike in the studio together. And he's an amazing guy, amazing engineer. And he helped me a lot, a very good mentor for me, and amazing producer. Then for Transference, we decided to do it ourselves. That was a, you know, a lot of responsibility and stuff.
And that was all at Public Hi-Fi?
No, a lot of it was in the Rare Book Room in New York. We work with Nicholas, who runs the studio there. And then Dave Sardi mixed half of it, and Nicholas mixed half of it.
Okay.
So working with Dave Sardi was great. And then this last record, we tracked half of it with Joe Ciccarelli, half of it with Dave Fridman, and then Dave Fridman mixed the entire record except for a couple songs. Mike mixed a couple.
So I know we have a lot of students here that are big Dave Fridman fans. If you're not familiar.
Me too.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Flaming Lips, Tame Impala, countless amazing albums and artists he's worked with. But talk a little bit about that experience of you yourself being a producer and engineer and a studio owner and then going into his space at Tarbox and working with him. What was that like?
Yeah, I felt like I was in class. It was pretty amazing.
Just taking notes while he's
taking notes, photos on everything, you know, just like, oh, what are you doing there, Dave? You know, what's that? You know, but it was just an amazing experience. He has a lot of great, really weird, esoteric gear. My favorite Dave Fridman quote of that entire time was, we were mixing and I said something like, Dave, do you think the drums are a little too distorted? And he's like, yeah, I'm the wrong person to ask about that. And he was telling us that he, you know, used to make everything clean and pristine, but then he started with the bands he's working with. He just feels that like things don't sound right unless there is some distortion to them, and that makes a lot of sense with the sounds of his records.
So how was it kind of welcoming somebody like that into the world of Spoon and letting them have a hand in the sound? And what were some of the best takeaways from that experience?
Man, there's a lot. I mean, the takeaways as far as for me personally or for what do you mean?
Maybe for you as an engineer and producer and then also as a band, how did it help Spoon become a better band through that experience?
Well, I figure like from a band standpoint, you know, we love everything he's done. And it was always very, maybe a little, we were all nervous about it, I think, because you think about Spoon, minimalist, and all these other space, all these other words. Those are words you don't use to describe Dave Fridman, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like, what is this going to sound like with that, mm-hmm. you know? But one of the things that Britt had mentioned is he did the last Sleater-Kinney record. Mm-hmm. And Janet Weiss and is friends of ours, and she was just like that Dave was really good at getting the sound that they wanted, you know, within his framework. So, you know, we felt like he could do it, and I feel like that's exactly what he did with Spoon. It still sounds like Spoon, but in my opinion, it's tougher sounding, more in your face, yet it's clear. Mm-hmm. I mean, I just don't know how he does that, but it's all these things that it's like, usually it's either bombastic or clear. He can do mm-hmm. so. He totally made it work with us. So
yeah, and what was it like mixing with him? How'd that?
Well, mixing. We were in Fredonia, New York, during the polar vortex, and we're Austin guys, so yeah. we're not used to that type of weather. And he would mix, and we would be. He would lock us out of the control room for about 8 hours.
So in the polar vortex.
Yeah, in the polar vortex. So we would be wandering his little studio with a blizzard, with nothing to do. He had this insane laser disc collection. So it was like The Shining, you know. We all like never shaved. It was.
Brutal.
It was really bad.
Longest years.
Yeah.
Longest
oh boy, it was. Yeah. It was like just dying for any human interaction besides the band, and yeah, it was pretty crazy.
So, what would it be like to come in then after you were locked out, freezing, bearded, and then come
yeah,
back
bearded,
into the control room?
In.
What was it like to hear to kind of that coming back at you from Fridman's perspective?
Max, rather. Yeah. Well, he did another thing when he would. Put up a mix, we would come in and he would be like, okay, well, you guys listen to it as many times as you want and I'll be out in the other room. And for all you recording producer people out there, that's really different, you know, to just let the band in a room listening to the mix and not take the feedback as it goes. But, I mean, I don't do that. I'm probably not... don't have enough confidence to do that, you know, but it shows his maturity and his confidence that he leaves us alone. And to be honest, sometimes we would be like, we are never going to get this to where we need it to be, you know? But then it's like, okay, deep breaths. Let's listen a couple more times and be like, okay, I see where he's going. Okay, cool. And then we would make notes and be like, okay, let's start with this. And he was amazing when it came to like mix changes, because it would be like, okay, we feel like, you know, we need to lower the room mics a little on the drums, you know, and he would be like, was that a funny Twitter question or no? Okay, we need to lower the room mics on the drums, and be like, okay, cool, what's next? And you'd be like, okay, cool, yeah, that sounds great.
Just really open to feedback.
Open to feedback, and I feel like that is a really good quality in a producer, is to not hold things like super dear and be offended if someone wants to change it. It's not your record, it's their record, mm-hmm. you know? Yeah. It's a Spoon record, it's not a Dave Fridman record. But the one time he gave us some pushback is I forget what song it is, but there's a cough in there, and one of our notes was, that the cough was like panned right and could we get it more center? And Dave's like, no, that cough needs to be on the right-hand side. And we're like, whoa, oh, dude, all right, it's there. We'll give you that one. We'll give you the cough.
Well, it's interesting too, because like, so, I mean, Dave Fridman definitely has a sound and a style, but by the same token, so does Spoon, and we were talking about this earlier, just, I find myself when I work with people and I talk to other producers, musicians will actually reference like, what would Spoon do in this situation?
Right.
Like taking an idea, a simple idea, letting it evolve throughout the course of the song, or taking a rhythm and kind of inverting it throughout it, or throwing in some kind of crazy angular element throughout
right.
it. So, kind of, if you would take maybe the last, let's Transference, that era, maybe 2007 through 2010, like you guys took a break. You got to this point with the album when it had come out and you then added another member. Like, how did that help you to reinvent and kind of come to where you are now?
I feel like Alex was a big part of recording this. Alex is our new guy. Big part of recording this latest record. I mean, he helped a lot with Inside Out, the piano solos and things. And I feel like live, it adds a different element. We used to like invite a friend on stage to help us play a couple songs on the last tour, on Transference tour. So we were moving towards adding another member, but Alex was just, you know, a perfect fit. Mm-hmm. I have a comment about, you were talking about like Spoon's sound and mm-hmm. stuff like that. One of the things that is interesting for like you producers out there, and when we did, I have two examples, like when we did this there was a New York Times interview with us about a song. The New York Times guy went in with us into the studio and watch this technique that we use, and also I'm working with this guy Walker Lukens, and this is a better example of what we do sometimes. Is you start a song and it's say a piano based song, and then you record all the basic tracks and you have the piano and you put a scratch vocal down. Anything you add to it never fits or never really works. You know, you try guitar, it doesn't work. You try keyboards, it doesn't work. So then you throw out the piano, and then everything works, you know? So the idea that whatever you start the song with, whatever instrument is, a lot of times it's best, it can work to remove that instrument. Like piano for this Walker Lukens track. Piano is an interesting one because it's obviously so many frequencies, it takes up so much room that once you remove that, it's like a breath of fresh air, you know? Mm-hmm. It has to work for the song, obviously, but just another little technique. And for the Spoon song, it was just this acoustic guitar that was just through the entire song. And once we removed that, everything else sort of was breathing a lot better. So,
sort of moving things down to kind of its most simple element.
Well, yeah, but the interesting thing about that is a lot of times when you say move it, cut it down to the most simple element, people get the demo stuck in their head, mm-hmm. or they get the initial thing that they tracked. A lot of times they don't even think about that very first instrument. So I know it seems easy, but you know.
Yeah. We had a question come through about the skills and experiences needed for a producer and engineer. And maybe to that, if you can share a little bit about what you were telling me earlier about in the studio, kind of making the music the main focus and not getting obsessed with either the visuals or other things that are going on.
Oh yeah, like with Spoon and with other bands, mainly with Spoon probably, because we did a lot of our records on tape. You can imagine working on tape, there's basically no computer in the room, there's two speakers and a track sheet. That's the only way you're keeping track of what's happening. And so the idea that there is no visual distractions at all. And so what we've been trying to do lately is turn off the monitors on the computer while we listen back to things, you know, leaving cell phones out of the room, you know, out of the control room and stuff, because I feel like it's just a distraction. And I mean, I've been, you know, I produce and I'm maybe working on a song and I'll be like, okay guys, what do you think? And I turn around and there's five people on the couch all on their computer, you know? And it's like, man, what a buzzkill, you know, are you?
Yeah, you're really excited about
it. Yeah, are you? I mean, that's the best thing I ever did, right there. Did you hear it?
So what have been some of the best moments in your role as a producer? I mean, you've had amazing albums. I was just listening to that Heartless Bastards album. I mean, there's so many great things that you've worked on.
Yeah.
What comes to mind at some of the best experiences that you've had in the studio?
Oh, boy. Let's see. Well, I think doing that Heartless Bastards record was pretty interesting because the way we did that is I really wanted to capture what that band did live. They always really blew me away live, and I wanted to capture that somehow. So I did about three or four pre-production rehearsals with them.
What was that process like?
It was just like in a rehearsal space, just going through the songs, talking about parts. I would have the song sketched out and be like, well, you know, it feels odd to me throwing another verse here. Can we try it without that? You know, just throw ideas at the band that they may not have thought of, because being in a band, I know how it is. You can sometimes not see the forest. You know, you're just too deep into it. So it's nice to have someone step back and suggest a few things. And you try them and you see if they work or not. So we did a bunch of those pre-production sessions, and then they toured for a month with Drive-By Truckers playing all the new songs, maybe two of their old songs. And the idea was that they would just road test these songs and be so ready to go. And so they came in after a month, and we tracked the entire record in about 4 days, And it was pretty much, I was the bottleneck in that too, because it would take me 4 or 5 hours to get all the sounds, because I wanted to get all the sounds keepers, like I heard mix-wise as they laid them down. So it was a lot of tweaking, a lot of mic placement and things. But then it'd be like, okay, yeah, guys, we're ready. And then it would be first or second take.
Wow.
I mean, it was pretty amazing. So I felt like that was a fun project because the process of it really worked, you know?
Just the value of pre-production.
Yeah. Well, pre-production also, you know, the idea of like, when you record a band that doesn't know the song, you can hear that in the performance. You can hear, or even me, if I don't know a song and I'm playing it, I always have, okay, is it the bridge or chorus next? You know, and then that little thought will cloud how your performance is. It sounds more mechanical. When you know the song so well, then all of a sudden you're working on your performance, not the structure of the song. Mm-hmm. So to get the band out of that environment, I think, is really, really important. It's hard to do now because a lot of bands aren't really, you know, road testing songs, you know, but I feel like there's just this added, you know, excitement when that happens, because that's when things happen that you'd never expect. So
when you have a band like Prowess Bastards, Tennis, Telekinesis, is that pretty much part of your process? Always go to pre-production, work on the arrangements before they get on the floor, the studio, and start tracking?
No, it's usually just most of the time I try, but a lot of times I can't. Like for Tennis, I heard demos and we talked about those over the phone, and then we tracked it at my place. For Telekinesis, so Michael Lerner is amazing. That was a great record to do too. That was me and him in the studio alone, basically doing that whole record. And one of the things he does, which I think is amazing, you think about it, he plays all the parts on the record, right? But what he does when he demos the songs, he does not edit or he doesn't punch in. So when he tracks, he has to play the song from start to finish. But what that does is that makes him learn those parts. So when he came into the studio, he was ready, and he would nail drum takes start to finish, like just with a click. I mean, it was really, really great, you know. But that was a method that he had come up with for himself that I thought was a really valuable, you know, way to do it.
Mm-hmm. So also with Public Hi-Fi, what's been the so it's about 16 years now? You've been in operation 17?
Yeah.
So you have, how many other engineers do you have? How do you kind of manage the studio while you're on the road and you're gonna be gone for 3 months? Do you have?
Yeah, I have two other guys that work with me, Brad Bell and Matt Gerhard. They're both house engineers. And depending on their schedules, I will assign, you know, a project to them if I get it on the road. Or I book the studio. I have someone who deals with scheduling for me. But it's really, you know, me plugging holes. And the good thing is, if someone books my studio and I'm not involved and I'm home, then I get a day off, which is important. Yeah. You know, I have to schedule those days off.
Those do exist.
I've heard of those. But I would work all the time. And so it's good. It's good to have other people working at my place. So
yeah. So what kinds of other artists have booked when you? I mean, you've had some pretty major ones, Arcade Fire. So actually, how did Lady Gaga end up down?
There's a guy in L.A. who it's Studio Referral Services, and he got my information, and he's been throwing like major acts that come through, and he asked me if there were 2 days open, and he's like, it's like a really big act. I'm like, okay, well, yeah, I have those days. And so we look at the pages, and I think we're like, okay, it's either Lady Gaga or Foreigner, or, you know, because those were the two big bands in that day. So, we had to sign, I don't even know if I can allow to talk about this. Can I say I had to sign an NDA, or is that covered under NDA? I don't know, but yeah. We did, you okay. know, yeah. I think it was just.
It's on your website, so.
Yeah. No. The fact that I signed an NDA. Okay. I think it's just that she wanted to make sure that she was having problems that people were showing up to the studio.
Oh, right.
And she's trying to record. And I mean, she was like booking studios on every day off she had. She was in a studio working on her record, and that's it, like, just dropped like while she was on tour. It was pretty crazy.
Yeah, so along with that, along with getting kind of referrals out of left field, talk about your experience with Tony Visconti and what that was like.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So I'm hanging with Brad at our little table, and I was just chatting about, you know, tube mic maintenance or whatever we always chat about. And I'm like, oh my God, I just got an email from Tony Visconti, personal email. And I'm like, jeez, you know, yeah, I'm nervous right now just talking about that. And so then I'm like, oh great, I have a conference call with Tony Visconti in half an hour. And
about the Foreigner album.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, sorry, that's true. I got to tell what he was. He was calling about using my studio for the Alejandro Escovedo record, which he was producing. And then he emails me, or he calls me, and he's like, hey, what do you think about engineering the record? And I'm like, you're an engineer. I mean, I've read your book and everything, and you engineer. He's like, yeah, I don't do that anymore. And I'm like, yeah, I'll do it, you know? Which, that's the kind of thing I was talking to a few of you. It's like, never turn anything down. Mm-hmm. Like, did I think I could engineer a record with Tony Visconti? No.
A little intimidating.
Yeah, I didn't. I mean, I figured I'd last like 2 days, and then he would bring a real engineer in, you know? But I made it, you know? But it was great. The first day, he's like, Jim, you know, I love what you do, so just do everything that you would do, and I will tell you if I don't like something. Mm-hmm. And I was like, cool, I'll just do what I normally do. And yeah, it was a pretty amazing experience. There's only one thing he didn't like that I did, but it was just, something was a little too roomy, so I
cough
with
was
that.
In the left.
Yeah, cough was on the left instead of the right.
Right.
Yeah.
Go with the Fridman. It's always cough on the right.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, as a producer, what were some lessons you took from him, and kind of how he worked with the artist and his process in the studio?
He's an amazing producer. I mean, he made me realize that there are many different types of producers. I mean, he's like, I will never be a producer like he is. I mean, he's unbelievable. Like, he will be doing harmonies with someone, and he'll just be like, no, sing the C, don't sing the B, you know, that. And I'm like, wow.
Just the ear.
I don't know if that blows, that may not blow anyone away out there, but it blows me away. I don't know. It's just, I can be a successful producer just by maybe hearing that something is off and suggesting a change, but I'm not going to be like him, you know? One thing I did talk to him about, though, that was pretty interesting is I have this theory, and it's probably not really a theory that's just mine, but I feel like a lot of very, very cool production techniques occur by people, by musicians and producers covering up mistakes. So I asked Tony about that, because I feel like you listen to T-Rex and Bowie, and there's like weird stuff all over the place.
I wonder, is it intentional? Or
intentional, or accidents, or how did all that occur?
So he gave you an example of something?
Yeah, yeah. So he was saying, when he was working on a couple of the T-Rex records, one song he laid down, he's like, hey, Mark, this song, this guitar is like, you know, it's either out of tune or you didn't play it right or something. I think we need to do another track. And you know, Mark's like, I'll drop an amp right there on top of that. No one will notice it, Tony. Come on, let's move on, you know? And he's like, okay. So then, the amazing thing about that is you fast forward 30 years, someone record, and they're like, oh my God, that amp that they dropped, what an amazing production idea, you know?
It's just a cover.
It has nothing to do with that. It's just covering up mistakes, you know? And I feel like as an engineer and as a producer, you're constantly troubleshooting and problem solving and trying to figure out, you know, anything to get the record done on time, basically. So
yeah, a few questions coming in just about how being a musician helps you in the producer's chair. What do you pull from that?
Yeah, there's quite a few. So, like, I've worked with a lot of producers. So I've been in a lot of really bad studio situations.
Without naming names, give us an example of something that was just a horrible situation.
See, something I can mention. I feel like one thing that I feel is very important is, and this is going to bore a lot of people, but talk back etiquette. I feel like, fascinating, right,
yeah,
Josh?
Yeah, so unpack that a bit.
Yeah. Basically, talk back etiquette just means like there's a musician in the studio, you're in the control room, there's a button called the talk back. Most of you people know this, I'll explain it. And then that's how you talk and back and forth to the musician. Musician has a mic in front of them. You can hear them. They can't hear you. So if you have a musician in the live room, and I've been in situations where I've done a drum take before, and I think it's great, and then I look in the control room, no one's paying attention, and everyone's talking in there, like, what do I feel? I feel like either they don't care, or I had an awful take, or...
Right, right.
They're calling the session drummer, you know, whatever. I don't know what to think, you know. And the studio can be a very isolating experience. And so I'm very conscious of, like, anytime anyone is out there, and I'll, like, try to keep the conversations down to a minimum in the studio and make sure that that person has my full attention. And then if we're having a conversation about the part, I'll always have the talk back on so the musician can, you know,
yeah,
listen. Little things like that, but, you know, so as a musician and as an artist, I can take all the good things I've learned from producers, try really hard not to do all these bad things that I've seen producers. The fact that, like, not my record, it's the band's record, that's a really important thing, you know. Working with John Bryan, amazing experience, and he is like Dave Fridman, where no idea is, like, sacred, you know. We'll charge down a path and he'll go for it, and then we'll be like, it's not really working, John. He's like, okay, cool, what about this? You know, it just, you know, that kind of attitude really helps. And to make the studio a really fun environment, you should be able to hear, like, that it was a good, fun recording experience when you listen to a record.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it seems like the producer really has the role in setting the atmosphere and the
tone.
Yeah,
totally, totally.
Yeah, like in your control room example, I think it's worse when somebody tells a joke that the drummer doesn't know, and everybody's laughing
yeah.
at the end of the drum take, and then they think they're laughing at me.
Yeah, oh yeah, there's so many things that with that whole talk back, that should be a chapter in that book you're writing, you know? Talk back etiquette.
Talk back chasm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll contact you about
good,
that.
Good, yeah, I'll do the preface.
Yeah. So, kind of transition. A lot of people have been writing in about the live performances that Spoon's become known for. And you guys have had just some amazing shows. I mean, we were talking about the Arcade Fire shows at Madison Square Garden. You guys are doing Bonnaroo. You got major festivals this summer. What are some of your favorite experiences? Like, where do you like playing? What kind of venue do you guys prefer?
Yeah, we prefer... standing room clubs. How's that for very specific?
Why is that?
We like playing indoors a lot better than outdoors because the sound mm-hmm. is usually better. We like to feel like an enclosed space. We like standing room because we've done shows in rooms like this where, you know, everyone's seated and sort of a buzzkill. So inside standing room clubs. And I would say one of that Auditorium Shores show at Supa Southwest, that has to go down to as one of my favorite. We played Hollywood Forever, the cemetery in Los Angeles, and it was an amazing venue too. So I feel like a couple of my favorite shows also have to do with, like, the space and things and Austin, that many people, and I feel like our lighting guy was on next level or something that day. It was like, wow. It was fun.
Yeah. We're going to take some questions in a few minutes. So if you have a question, if you maybe want to make your way up to the microphone, but we've got one on each side of the aisle here. But I know a lot of students, like, ask me, and have probably asked you, like, what advice would you give? How would you make your way into the music industry? And, you know, getting an electrical engineering degree is probably not the standard music industry
right,
answer.
Yeah.
But yeah, from your perspective now, kind of looking back, I mean, I think the Auditorium Shore Show is a kind of a good marker on the other side of just the level of success you guys have had just from starting out to playing to 10 people
right.
in Austin. So what would you say to somebody that asks you that?
Well, yeah, this is a very difficult question because there is no one path. So I use this example. That band OK Go. Mm-hmm. Everyone knows that band, right? And so I know those guys. And just imagine if they were in the audience and they raised their hand and they're like, how do I get started in the music business? I never would have thought to say, make a treadmill video. You know, so that right there proves that you can get into the music business many different ways. And there's nothing really that I can say that is the right path. You know, I would say, you know, diversity, do as many different things as you can. Don't turn things down. Figure it out as you go. Yeah, just do as much as you can, you know?
Well, it's interesting, too, like going to the OK Go example. I was at the Future Music Coalition conference, and they were there talking about that process. And what he said people don't realize is that they brought that idea to Capital, who they were signed with at the time.
Right, yeah.
And the head of the digital marketing department looked at that and turned it off and said, no one can ever see this. It will destroy your career. And they filmed it, I don't know, for $2,000-$3,000,
yeah.
whatever the cost.
Oh, if that. I mean,
yeah. He was at his sister's house for
yep.
2 days.
Yeah.
And he said, and basically it was like from that point on, they realized like nobody knew what they were talking about.
Exactly,
the label.
Right. Yep.
And it seems like part of that component of success, or at least finding a way to have something sustainable, is to really believe in your vision of what you're doing and as you're going, along the journey, learning as you go and developing
yeah.
something.
Yeah. Yeah, like when we were on Elektra, the single for Series of Sneaks was Car Radio, and I think it's a minute and 35 seconds or so, or it's very, very short, right? And it was only like 10 seconds shorter than Song 2, that Blur song, you know? So we kept using that. We're like, well, this Blur song is, and they'd be like, well, you're not Blur, you know? So they made us do a radio edit that extended it. Which maybe, I've never heard of that happening before, so that could be the only time ever a label's told a band to extend a song for the radio. That was very difficult. We didn't do a very good job at it, and we had one version that had, Third Eye Blind had that band, Elektra had that band Third Eye Blind, so we took part of that chorus and just threw it right into the middle of Car Radio. As our extension.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
So.
It was longer.
Yeah.
And that chorus is a hit, you know?
One last thing before we take questions, and again, you can make your way up to a microphone if you have a question. One of the things you were mentioning on the way down here was the idea of diversifying kind of the team of people that have to operate around Spoon to make that work, and that you were telling me that it just is exemplary of like how many opportunities there are to get involved in the industry that don't involve being a drummer or
yeah.
being something immediate in the band. Can you expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, I guess there are like so many jobs in the music business that you know you can latch on to. It's very exciting. You just have to know what they are basically. They only sort of just you just have to hear about them. So, like, for one example is, I had a friend, a guy I was talking at UT like this, and he came up after, and he's like, I'm an accountant, but I want to do, you know, get in the music business. What should I do? And I'm like, well, you know, there's business management and stuff. I'm like, what else? What do you do to make money? I was like, well, I run live sound. And I'm like, okay, you need to be a tour manager, because a tour manager is someone that every band wants, not every band can afford one, but two of the very important positions on the road is a tour manager, because that's the guy that insulates the band from everything else, and then the sound guy, because he makes the band sound good. So usually, those are almost the two people you pay first, and this guy would be able to do both and market himself, and in a year, he had like too much work to do. So he quit, and he's like, an accountant now or something. Anyway, it was a good story.
Yeah.
So for Spoon, we have a manager, and there's like, we have a couple day-to-days underneath that. So there's management, we have a lawyer, we have a booking agent, business manager. Who am I missing? What else do we have?
So in the tour support, do you guys have people doing publicity?
Yeah, we have a press person, right? Press. And then licensing. We have people looking for our songs licensing-wise. Commercials. What else? Then on the touring side, there's techs. So there's drum techs, guitar techs. There's monitor engineers, front-of-house engineers. There's production manager, merchandise. That's how, so our manager, his name is Ben Dickey. He's awesome. We met him, boy, I don't even know when, really, really early on. He was in high school. He interviewed Britt for his high school paper. That's how we met him. And he ended up going out as our merch guy. Then we brought him on as a tour manager. Then he became our co-manager and then our manager. So he worked his way up from being basically our t-shirt boy all the way up to our current manager. So, and he manages like Explosions in the Sky, Future Islands, and Acaville River, and you know, a bunch great of different bands.
So by my count then, you've got 50 to 60 people in the organization, something around there maybe, if you include.
Ooh, that seems like
all in.
It's like
for the tour.
Kanye big.
Yeah.
Seems too big.
But I think
I don't think I would say more like 25. Hopefully.
We'll call it 35. All right. So, but nonetheless, like a lot of positions that aren't just musicians, but are career positions of people.
Of course, yeah, exactly. A lot of non-music related people are helping us.
But along with that then, and this will just be the last point, we'll start taking questions, but the other thing I hear in what you're saying is that there's such a value in the relationships of having people that you know, that you trust, that are easy to work with and be around, so that you can take the t-shirt person and elevate them because they've demonstrated the ability to be professional and be willing to put in the extra work and all that. It's not just you apply and you get in. It's actually you know people and they trust you, and from there you're able to kind of move forward.
Exactly. Yep. And you're good at your job. You have a good work ethic, and you know, you are okay to be on the road with 24/7. You know, I mean, the van is a. Our old producer called it a personality magnifier. It's pretty crazy.
Crucible.
Yeah, it's just like, you know, someone at the start of a tour may be drinking their drink a certain way, and then by the end, you know, strangle them for drinking that way. So
it's a good segue to questions.
Yeah.
I think I had a question over here.
You said that you started so late in college playing like the drums. How did you, like, what was the reason why you started so late? Like, what just brought you to the drums?
What brought me to the drums?
Yeah, just so late.
So I knew I wanted to play drums from like a very, very early age. And I tried to play in middle school. And at my middle school, I grew up in Rhode Island, and you couldn't play drums in seventh grade. You had to wait till eighth grade. So seventh grade, I'm like, I want to play the drums. They're like, no, you can only play till next. Have to wait till next year. So I'm like, okay, well, I guess I'll play the saxophone then. So I played saxophone first year. First day of eighth grade, I walk in, and I'm like, I want to play the drums. And my music teacher's like, only idiots play the drums. And he wouldn't let me switch because I was like first chair saxophone. So then I played for about a month and I quit. So I always knew I wanted to play the drums, and my mom's always like, oh, I should have bought you a drum set a long time ago. And I'm like, nah, don't worry about it. It worked out, Mom. You know, it worked out. But I always knew I wanted to do it. And then when I was in college, I was doing a co-op program. Do you guys know what that is? They have them in some schools where you go to school, but then you work in a different job full-time every other semester. So I went to school in Raleigh. I worked at IBM in Manassas, Virginia for every other semester. But then I had almost a year and a half of work experience when I got out. So I had a real job basically, and I was making some extra money, non-college money, so I went and bought a drum set with that, and yeah, it's pretty great.
Thank you.
Thanks, yeah.
Cool. Any other questions, audience? That one over here.
There is a specific track that I heard called The Ghost That Lingers,
and yeah.
that's a really interesting track for me because it's like it's something that kind of blew me away as sort of like abstract, and I just wanted to ask what your role was in creating that song with Britt.
Okay, because there are no drums on that song.
Yeah.
moral support. I probably got some Diet Cokes for him. What else?
Is there like a collaboration process as a whole band though for like a song like that?
Or yeah, it is. I mean, you know, we're constantly like checking with each other to make sure that this is working in the right direction. And, you know, I probably engineered some of the sounds, but I know for that song, a lot of that was a demo. A lot of the demo was used. So we do that a lot where Britt writes demos and his demos are really good. And so we'll, like, even from the early days, we would fly stuff over to tape from his demo and things.
Does he have, like, a home setup that he works on?
Now he has Pro Tools with some nice gear, you know. But he's getting back to writing on his 4-track again for limitations. And again, we're always, it's a love-hate relationship with the computer and the screen and everything. So, but anyway, I mean, I can't recall like specific things, but I would just say, you know, we're always in there together as everyone's a team trying to make the song sound the best it can. So,
cool. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. To that question, maybe expand a little bit. So Britt brings a song in. What does the process look like once it goes through all the members of Spoon? Like, how does it become the final product in terms of the arrangement?
But yeah, it's a lot of different ways. Yeah. So, I mean, we do these things. Our pre-production is a lot of times take a demo, and then someone will be like, "Well, what would it be like if you know, Marvin Gaye played this song?" So we'll listen to a bunch of Marvin Gaye and get some references, and then be like, "Okay, let's go. Let's go out and we'll try to play it like Marvin Gaye. I'll do a drum beat, and we'll just all do our interpretation of that, and." A lot of times it's not very good, and then we'll just be like, okay, let's try something else. And so, but sometimes we may hit on something or a part or even a sound that we will record that when we go back later, we're like, let's grab that, let's use that and things. So, you know, but then there are other songs that are, you know, a lot of it is the demo, and then we'll just build from there. And if something doesn't sound good, we'll just, you know, re-record that one part, you know. But like Knock 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 and Inside Out, those were built up a lot from just with Fridman, just from the start.
Great,
you know?
Songs.
Yeah. Inside Out was sort of interesting because me and Britt had played that just in my live room and recorded it. And what Fridman did is he took the drum part. And then his initial stab at the drum beat was sort of replicating one live take that I did. But I didn't play on that song, but it was sort of programmed based on what my live take was, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah.
Interesting.
So,
we have a question down here.
You guys have had some, like, not so obvious radio songs, something like Written in Reverse or something. Do you guys think about which songs could potentially be singles when you're in the studio writing, or does that kind of come later?
It's a good question. I think it usually comes later. Yeah. And then the process of picking a single is always, I don't know how it happens. So it's... Like, I feel like there are always songs on the record that I'm like, man, why wasn't that a single, you know? Our radio people. See, I remembered someone else that works with us. Yeah. Those people figure out the single.
35.
Yeah. 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 But I feel like we don't write for the radio, definitely. you know, I feel like in the past, sometimes we may have sort of sabotaged stuff, you know, just because it's like, we don't, you know, let's distort that a little bit more.
One thing I actually wanted you to mention that you have been telling me about was the kind of value of Spotify in the studio as a producer. Can you talk about that, your kind of process of building playlists for artists while you're working?
Yeah, I just, I don't know, I feel like with streaming and everything, it's really easy to pull up references now, you know? So what I'll end up doing, it's pretty obvious, but before I used to have to buy records, now I just pay for the streaming service and I can access anything that any wants to play for me, because I don't have everything. And a lot of times you work with a band and I've never even heard of these songs or their references, you know? So what I'll do is I will start a playlist of the band when I start the song, you know, and the record, and then I will just throw all the references in there, which would be like, you know, a way to capture all that and see it later on. So
how is, like, with Spotify and all the kind of shift to streaming, you say you love Spotify, most artists are kind of go back and forth in terms of kind of how that future is going to look. What do you guys land with that?
Well, yeah, I don't know how much time we have. But for me, I mean, like, I look at it like as a user. I mean, I love it. You know, I mean, it really, I love the interface. I love how it helps me when I'm making records. I've discovered a lot of music by using it. So in that case, I, you know, I'm a big fan. And, you know, I have a technology background, so I'm a big fan of usability and speed and things like that. And it just works for me. Mm-hmm. It may not work for everyone, but it works in what I do. I wish they would pay more, but I feel like, you know, that's going to happen as more subscribers come on board. Mm-hmm. Again, I mean, the more artists get paid, the better. So,
yeah.
You know, I'm all for it.
Yeah. Any other questions? Because I have one. All right. So the last question I want to ask is, and I was asking about for people in school, for graduates, kind of how you'd recommend or what advice you'd give in terms of kind of being in the music industry. But what advice would you give to artists that are looking to make their way through all the changes that are going on and just, again, the kind of changing landscape in the industry right now that want to break through?
Yeah, I would say don't even think about breaking through, you know? Write the songs and make the records that you're most proud of and that you're going to be happy with years and years from now. Don't try to be something that you're not. Because I've always felt like if you do something really good and you really love it, other people are going to get that, mm-hmm. you know? And then, you know, just to be able to live with yourself that you're doing really good music and hopefully people will get it, mm-hmm. but don't try to chase fads or do anything like that.
When you're producing people that might be just starting out, do a lot of them come to you for advice about, like, how to navigate release or maybe even picking a single?
Yeah. And I'll, like, you know, I usually have an opinion about everything, so I'll, like, talk about it. But again, like the OK Go example, it's just, you just never know mm-hmm. what, you know, what's going to happen. So one thing we did learn early on in Locust years, though, is we learned that, touring and not having your fan base go up is a definite possibility. Because when we were starting, everyone was like, oh, just stay on the road forever and that's how you do it. And we got to the point where it was really just not worth it. So we try to do really targeted tours now and make it matter and stuff. So, I mean, you know, there are some bands that I feel like may play their hometown too much, you know, that kind of thing. And so it's not special when they play anymore, you know. I understand having to make money and all that stuff, but it's just always trade-offs. It's always like, well, are we playing too much? Who knows, you know?
Great. Well, Jim, thanks so much for joining us. If you are going to be out and about this summer, you guys are playing Columbus, I think, June 12th, is that right?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Some of you guys have tickets. Okay, yeah, June. Yeah.
So, and Bonnaroo, everybody's going to be at Bonnaroo. For yeah. Great festival. So, be sure to...
We'll be camping there.
Yeah.
No.
Come over. Yeah,
let's do it.
Yeah, awesome. Well, Jim, thanks so much. And
yeah, thanks for having me, everyone.
Yeah.